In 3, 2, 1. From New York to Hollywood, London to Chicago, over the years, I've interviewed some of the biggest stars, gone behind the scenes of the hottest shows, and had rare access to royal insiders. Join me as we open the WFTV archives and take a step back in time. This is the Video Vault. I'm Martie Salt, and in this episode, America's Game, Wheel of Fortune, ranks as the longest running game show ever. Pat Sajak and Vanna White came on board in the early 1980s. By 1985, Wheel was a worldwide phenomenon. That's when I went to Los Angeles to go behind the scenes of Wheel and meet the pop icons simply known as Pat and Vanna.
So anyway, I just came over to say hi and welcome you and to answer some questions you might be curious about. Does anybody have any questions? Yes. How old am I? That's always the first question. But I'm not afraid to admit it. I'm 28. Are you disappointed?
Before each taping, you're likely to find perky Vanna White meeting and greeting the audience just like her southern personality would lend itself to. This girl next door type of image is what helped sell the producers on Vanna 3 years ago when they auditioned over 200 young women for the hostess spot. That, plus the fact that she was able to turn the right letters more quickly and gracefully than anybody else. Pat Sajak's dry sense of humor and basically his personality were what clinched the deal for him. He was handpicked by Merv Griffin, the creator of the show, who had seen Pat during his days as a TV weatherman. In between show tapings at the Burbank Studios, Pat and Vanna talked about their ride on this wheel of success and where it's taking them.
How did Wheel of Fortune get to be number one and stay there and be the strongest game show on television now?
It's the host and hostess, basically.
Is that it? I figured you'd say something like that.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. Do you have an answer for that? Because
no.
I've been asking you, right. We've asked that a lot. And I haven't the foggiest idea.
No.
So, Vanna, take it.
Well, I just think my personal opinion is that it's an easy game that everyone of all ages can play. You know, it's something that you can have your granddaughter, your daughter, your grandmother, all in the same room playing the same game.
Now, Pat, do you know the phrase when they start the show?
Just before each round, they let me know, so I don't look too stupid out there.
Yeah, so you can give an idea of what's going on. What fascinated me about you, Pat, when I read your biography and all, was that you had been a weatherman.
Yeah.
And actually, the game show hosting had come later in your career. You'd been a weatherman in Nashville and then Los Angeles.
Yeah, I've been a lot of things. There's no logic to this business. I mean, you just sort of take what comes along, and a game show came along. I mean, this is not something I aspire to necessarily.
How did it happen?
I was doing the weather in Los Angeles. Merv Griffin owns the show, and he liked my work, and so he asked me to do it.
He liked the way you did the weather.
Yeah, but, he liked the way I handled myself on television. I mean, it's just because you do one thing doesn't mean you can't do something else.
Yeah, so you were open to the idea of trying out a game show?
Sure, I figured, what the heck, I had nothing to do for a couple of years.
Is it good enough to stay in it for years to come?
Yeah, but again, you know, who knows? I mean, I didn't intend to be a game show host. Mm-hmm. I didn't intend to be a weatherman. So I may end up doing this for 40 years, or I may be a plumber in 6 months, you know? Hard to
but
say.
Not making the kind of money you're making now.
No, my plumber does real well.
Oh, okay. Design plumbing.
Yeah.
That kind of thing. Vanna, I was reading an article about you, and you said you thought that your role in this job was a blow to feminism. Now, what do you mean?
A blow to feminism.
Did you say that?
That's what People Magazine said. Did they quote you wrong?
Yes.
Oh,
yes.
They're scum. They don't
know
what
they're
saying.
They also said that I have blue eyes.
Oh, they're very brown.
What else did they say that was inaccurate? Everything.
No.
They are scum, but go ahead.
No, I'm not a woman's liver at all. Everyone is equal, and everyone asks me, don't you want to do more on the show, and all you do is turn the letters. But I love my job. I really do. I wouldn't trade it in for anything. I have a wonderful time.
Actually, your role is different because, at least I don't know of any other game show where they introduce, a co-hostess.
Exactly.
Type of thing. Do they?
Not that I know of. No, I'm fortunate that Pat introduces me and all those people know that I'm Vanna White, which is a nice feeling that I have a name.
Pat, you mentioned a lot of people read that magazine article in People Magazine and all.
Yeah.
I mean, is it truth? Is it fiction?
Generally fiction. It's a touchy subject for me because they're such really unpleasant, nasty, rotten people that I'd difficult for me to talk about.
You don't like talking about your personal life?
Not much. It's not that I don't like it. I always feel silly doing it. I mean, I don't understand Yeah, I mean, what I eat for breakfast or where I spend my spare time seems a little weird to talk about.
You don't like mixing professional and personal?
I guess. It just seems a little silly. I mean, is that fair? I don't know.
Yes. No, I agree with you. Yeah. It's just a lot of things were taken out of context. And that, you know, they made us, I thought we're pretty decent people, I think.
Yes. You know? Just because I would call someone scum does not make me a bad person. No.
Why shouldn't you? Vanna, it's so competitive. I was thinking, I hope this part is true. You were chosen out of, what, 200, 300?
Yes, I was.
Women trying out for this part?
Yes.
What makes you stand out when you go to compete for something like that?
What was it, Pat? No, actually, I don't know. Merv Griffin made the final decision through a process of elimination, and quite honestly, I did not think I had it.
Pat, what do you see in Vanna? What would make her have it?
You know, it's funny, Vanna was, in fact, we finally got it down to about a dozen women who did a kind of an on-air, not an on-air, but an on-tape chit-chat segment with me, just see how we work together. And Vanna was by far the most nervous of the bunch.
I mean,
her lips were quivering and everything.
And we,
those of us on the staff talked afterwards and said, gee, it's too bad. She's, a lovely gal, obviously, and could be a lot of fun, but I think she was just too nervous. But fortunately, Merv Griffin is a pretty good judge of talent and apparently was able to see through the nervousness and see that would settle down in time. So whatever he saw worked out very well.
One last question before we take off. How long can this wheel ride?
I don't know. I figure another 4 years, 3 months, 2 weeks,
days.
I think it shows no sign of slackening,
no.
So I guess it'll be around for a while.
Just as long as it can stay there and you'll be here.
I guess so.
Yes.
All right. Thanks so much, Pat. Thank you, Vanna.
Thank you.
32 years after that interview, and Wheel of Fortune hasn't slowed down a bit. I caught up with Pat and Vanna again in 2017 when they were taping shows at Epcot and learned that Pat now lives in Central Florida part-time.
Our kids kind of grew up around Disney. We work with them a lot. It's just a great company to work with, and it's been a great relationship. We do it so much that we just kind of got caught up in it. One day we're looking and saying, let's buy that. And so now we're part of Central Florida.
Well, how about that? Who knew?
Who knew?
And when people recognize him, what is the first thing they ask?
By far, it's, can I buy a vowel? Now that's okay. I understand. But what interests me is the phenomenon you just described, which is they think I've never heard it before. So they not only say, can I buy a vowel, but they almost double up in laughter at the witticism that they just laid on me. And I try to be good-natured and laugh, and sometimes I charge them $250.
And as for Vanna, it's all about her massive wardrobe.
The designers send probably 30 or 40 dresses to the studio. I try them on, and we pick the top 12, because we usually do 12 shows in 2 days. And so we pick the top 12 of those, and I wear them, and then I take them off, and then they go back to the designer. So I don't get to keep them, and I've never worn the same dress twice.
Do you ever buy one of the dresses? Do you ever say, hey, that's really a favorite?
Sometimes I ask if I could borrow it for a charity event or some big event that I go to, and most of the time they say yes.
Up next, on the set and behind the scenes of Wheel of Fortune, what it takes to get the show on the air.
The Video Vault continues with Martie Salt.
The most fascinating part of television programs, really, is watching what goes on behind the scenes. Some things have changed since Wheel of Fortune hit the air more than 30 years ago, but the fundamentals are the same.
Two, lots of smiling.
Look at this studio, filled with fantastic prizes.
This is where Merv Griffin Productions is making a fortune. In this one soundstage inside the NBC studios in Burbank is where the daytime and nighttime versions of Wheel of Fortune are taped. What appears to be a simple game show is making television history, and this is how it all comes together. While hostess Vanna White is being made up in the makeup room before showtime, just a few yards away, the studio audience is waiting patiently to be escorted inside.
Tell me, why do you like Wheel of Fortune?
Because it's really fun to watch, and I like trying to guess what the answer is.
Oh, it's fun to see all the people get real excited about it and everything.
Pat Sajak.
That's your attraction?
That's my attraction.
Are you a regular watcher of Wheel of Fortune?
Definitely.
Why is that? Why definitely?
I just enjoy it.
More so than other shows? Other game shows?
it's one of my favorites anyway, especially the evening show anyway. I catch it every night.
Before the audience comes in, the floor crew gets the prizes in place. Now, that includes quickly maneuvering a new car in the space of a few feet. Also, camera angles are arranged, and the contestants, who have been chosen several days earlier, rehearse a practice game.
And the opportunity to win an exciting prize.
Suddenly, it's 4 p.m. and time to tape the first of five shows that will be taped this Friday night. As a matter of fact, taping will continue through the weekend.
This studio filled with fantastic prizes.
Wheel of Fortune is Merv Griffin's own idea of a glorified hangman game. Guess the right letter, solve the puzzle, and win some fabulous prizes. Everything from home furnishings to trips, furs, and new cars.
The game is a fun game to play. Everybody in the family can play it. You know, from 6 to 106, you can play Wheel.
Nancy Jones has been the producer of Wheel since its inception 10 years ago. She and Merv Griffin work closely, overseeing every aspect of the show, from buying some of the prizes to thinking of the puzzles.
Yes, a lot of the puzzles are his suggestions. I say if it's a real hard puzzle, you know it's Merv's.
I've read where he said there's one TV personality who comes up with so many cliches, he's like a gold mine for him.
Yeah, I don't know who that person is. He hasn't revealed his source of these cliches. But he comes in with lists. You know, he does a lot of traveling, and I always know where he's been because he comes in with cocktail napkins and puzzles written on them.
Four, thank you. Three, two.
All right, let's go.
The show is shot in 1.5 hour, exactly as it will be televised, unless, of course, there are unexpected problems, like an overanxious member of the audience shouting out an answer, or if a contestant's letter is mistaken for another, or if the wheel breaks down. By the way, during commercial breaks and at times like these, the contestants immediately turn their backs to the puzzle, lest they use the extra time to solve the game. Commercial breaks can be the most interesting part of these game shows. All the action takes place backstage, where the puzzles are changed, blocks put in place, and the board rolled back on stage within 2 minutes.
Jack Clark will enumerate them for us now.
I certainly will, Patrick. Darla, we begin with this for someone special. It's Gucci.
This is Jack Clark. He's the possessor of that mysterious voice you hear introducing the show and describing the prizes. He checks off the prizes on a list as the winner names them off so he can quickly explain them again. Meanwhile, somebody else is working a calculator to keep a running total of the money. That message is then relayed to the floor. Why is Wheel of Fortune one of the hottest properties on television today? Well, nobody can seem to answer that. Some say it's greed, viewers lusting after all that loot. Others say it's just good TV.
We just try and always make sure that we set a high standard. We never do anything that is in bad taste, or at least we try not to. Sometimes you can't help but offend someone. You know, there's always maybe somebody that's going to be offended by something. But we try and make sure that you would never be embarrassed if your mother saw this show, right? And Merv and I, when we talk about puzzles and everything, we always think in that framework.
The nighttime syndicated version of Wheel of Fortune that you see on Channel 9 has been airing for 36 years. Reportedly, Pat and Vanna have contracts that run through 2020, so that wheel is going to be spinning for quite a while longer. There's more to come on the Video Vault. Who is Jeopardy host Alex Trebek? I got an unexpected surprise when I met up with him at his newly built Los Angeles home.
We're going back into the video vault with Martie Salt, the year 1985.
Alex Trebek is the host of the other game show powerhouse, Jeopardy. He's hosted that show since 1984. In 1985, I interviewed Alex at what was his then newly built home in Los Angeles. I just expected he would meet us at the front door, but that wasn't quite the case.
I know what I'm about.
Yeah.
But
digging his own pool with a shovel is not the image of a successful game show host, but it's exactly the way we found Jeopardy host Alex Trebek one recent morning at his Los Angeles home.
Situated on the side of a hill near exclusive Laurel Canyon, this three-story Art Deco home was designed and built by Trebek a year and a half ago, before the all-new Jeopardy came along.
Welcome back. In about 2 minutes from now, we'll know which of these three places...
Jeopardy had been off the air 6 years when Merv Griffin Productions decided to bring it back. Trebek had hosted other TV game shows, including a Canadian show called Strategy in the early 70s. Griffin approached Trebek about hosting and producing Jeopardy.
You mentioned before that Jeopardy was not, is not your first game show. You did High Rollers before, you did several others, and for different reasons they were canceled. I would think at some point you would just get tired of being in that business and say, let's just move on to something else.
Well, it's a good business. I am tired of it in some respects, and I wasn't going to do another game show, but then they approached me to do Jeopardy, and it's a class show. And I had an opportunity to produce as well as host, so I took the job.
Now, what does that mean to you, an opportunity to produce for viewers? You know, what does that mean to them that Alex Trebek is also the producer of Jeopardy?
That means I hire the staff. I'm responsible for putting the show together. I review all the material. I hire the people who select the contestants. I set the tone for the show.
You have the control over it, then?
Yeah. And I make suggestions with regard to changes in the game, improving the look of the show. We're going to make some changes again for this second season.
Who comes up with the questions?
I have a staff of six researchers, and I make suggestions, and they come up with ideas, and they run them by me, and I say, okay, or no, I don't like that. We won't use that one. We'll use this. I review all of the material that winds up on the air. Everything comes in front of me, and if I don't approve it, it doesn't get on the air. Although that's not quite true. There have been cases where I have said, I don't want to use this, and my head writer comes in and argues in favor of it, and I will yield and say, okay, I'll defer to you on this one, but I'm not too happy. We'll see how it goes.
Are there certain types of questions that would not end up on Jeopardy?
I don't like questions that have to do with perhaps making snide remarks or picking apart some of the people in show business right now. I don't think that's our function. Mm-hmm. You know, making a comment about a famous star who's getting a divorce or something like that.
Jeopardy always has been.
So we're going to stop the tape just for a second so I can tell you this little story. This was actually a January day in California, and I was not prepared. It ended up being a very chilly day, so I was shivering in Alex's house. He noticed I was shivering, so he ran upstairs and he grabbed what turned out to be his mother's sweater coat, and he let me wear it for the rest of the day. So anyway, ultimately, fortunately, it worked out with what I was wearing. But anyway, just wanted to tell you that quick story. So let's pick up where we left off.
One of the most intelligent game shows on TV. You had to really know something to be able to compete. How do you pick the contestants?
We have four different tests right now, 40 answers apiece, and we vary them from time to time. For the coming season, we are replacing those 40 with two new tests. Each of those tests will have 50 answers. And we set a cutoff point. And the people who score above that remain for the second part of the test, which is a game-type competition against two other players. And we interview them also to find out if they have personality, if they're lively enough, and if they take well to competition. Some people shrink in the face of competition. They're very bright. We've had people take our test and make one mistake, and then they get up there in competition, and you can see them visibly back away because of their personalities. They're not used to confrontation. And let's face it, a show like Jeopardy is a confrontation. You're standing up there and you're trying to win. And in order to win, you have to defeat two other people. You've got to be smarter than them and faster than them. And not everyone is able to meet that particular challenge.
Is there a lot of pressure on a game show host to make sure that that show is a success?
If the game is really good, the host would have to be very bad to destroy the game.
What makes him bad?
Well, there are hosts who aren't able to function on their feet particularly well. They perhaps try to upstage the contestants. A host's function is to keep the game moving, provide an environment that will enable the contestants to perform at their best. Don't get in the way of the contestants. The contestants are the stars of the show. Now, that's not to say that you can't have personality as well. On Jeopardy, I kid around. I get silly. We tape 5 shows a day, 2 days a week. By the time I'm taping the 8th and 9th show, I'm tired. Because in addition to the hosting, I've also been doing my producing job on those 2 days as well. And so I'm putting in 2 14-hour days, and I get tired, and I get a little silly. I don't mind that. I don't do it a lot, so I'll make a few comments. But yet, there are people out there in television land who write in, they resent that. They don't want me to be funny. They don't like my little attempts at humor. They want, just read the answers, dummy. And that's what they say in their letters to me. Just read the answers. Well, as I have written those people, I don't think that there is too much entertainment involved in just listening to 50 answers being read in a half-hour program and 50 responses to those answers. Mm-hmm. I think we need some personality from the host and from the contestants to make it an entertaining half hour. And I will stick by my guns. And I'm happy to report that most people seem to agree. Most of the mail that I have received indicates that the viewers are happy with the way I'm doing the show, and they enjoy the little bits of humor.
When Trebek is not taping the show, and they tape 5 shows a day, 2 days a week, he's working on other projects, like his pool. And for 5 months, he worked on his house.
I ran all the telephone cables and all the television cables through the house the day before and the morning that the drywallers came in. They're putting up 4x12 sheets, so they're covering a lot of wall, and I'm drilling through the studs and doing all that. And I ran all the conduits for bringing in the power from the city, 3-inch steel conduits up the side of the hill, and put in concrete boxes for it and did all of that stuff. I was involved in every aspect of it for 4.5 months. I was here at 6 o'clock in the morning until dark. And I got it done, and I'm proud of what I did because there are some design elements that are good. And I have a lot of people who stop by, architectural students, lawyers, accountants, who want to know who designed it.
Jeopardy actually has quite a history. The original daytime version started in 1964, and here it is still on the air. And you know the tune used for Final Jeopardy? Well, that was composed by the show's creator, Merv Griffin, and he estimated that the use of that 30-second tune had earned him royalties of more than $70 million during his lifetime. It is time to close this edition of the Video Vault. Until next time, I'm Marty Salt, signing off.